What springs to mind when we hear the words trait and inheritance? Many of us picture Mendel and his P experiments. Mendel's theory of inheritance states that organisms inherit two alleles for each trait, one from each parent. You could say it's easy peasy. I apologize in advance for many terrible puns to come. Mendel's theory works well with qualitative traits, where offspring can be placed into categories. For example, a cross between a homozygous smooth and homozygous wrinkled pea plant will produce a heterozygous pea that appears smooth as the smooth allele is dominant. However, not all traits can be explained so simply. Many traits are quantitative and display continuous variation, such as human height. How can we begin to make sense of these complex traits? In 1909, Nilsson-Ehle and East found that these quantitative traits result from multiple genes and their interaction with the environment. This discovery became the root of many pioneering experiments throughout the 20th century which detected linkage to quantitative trait loci, or QTLs. A QTL is the position of a gene within a chromosome that affects a particular quantitative trait. New discoveries really began sprouting. In 1923, Sachs found that seed weight in the common bean was linked to genes controlling the color of the bean. In 1967, Law identified and mapped factors relating to wheat grain weight, grain number, and height. In 1982, Tanksley, Medina, Filo, and Rick used isozyme loci to locate factors influencing stigma length, fruit weight, and seed weight in tomatoes. Just when you thought it couldn't get any better, in 1988 a breakthrough in QTL mapping came about, and the star of the show? The humble tomato. Tomato, tomato, right? Actually, it's a little bit juicier than that. Tomatoes, with the help of some scientists, changed the world of genetics and agriculture forever. Paterson and colleagues were the first to use a complete restriction fragment length polymorphism linkage map to find Mendelian factors from quantitative traits in tomatoes. The traits they investigated were fruit mass, concentration of soluble solids, and pH. Fruit mass and the concentration of soluble solids are agriculturally important, as a high mass and high soluble solids concentration increases the yield of tomato paste. And as a pasta lover, the more tomato paste, the better. The scientists crossed the domestic tomato Lycopersicon esculentum and a wild South American tomato Lycopersicon chmielewskii, growing 237 backcross plants in total. Domestic tomatoes have an average fruit mass of 65 grams and a 5% concentration of soluble solids. Wild tomatoes have an average fruit mass of 5 grams and a 10% concentration of soluble solids. These differences meant that the backcross plants showed continuous variation. RFLPs are variations in lengths of DNA fragments due to mutation, obtained by digesting DNA with a particular enzyme. They can be used to construct genetic maps from recombination data through comparing the probabilities of marker linkage. Paterson and colleagues constructed a genetic linkage map of tomato with over 300 RFLPs and 20 isozyme markers that span across all 12 chromosomes. For QTL mapping, the researchers chose a subset of 70 markers to be scored for each of the backcross progeny. They then analyzed the relationship between each RFLP and phenotypic trait. This allowed them to create a map of markers that affect fruit mass, soluble solids concentration, and pH. Paterson and colleagues identified factors for fruit mass on 6 chromosomes. They found that the wild tomato alleles decrease fruit mass, accounting for 47% of the weight difference between domestic and wild tomatoes. In addition, they found factors for soluble solids concentration on 4 chromosomes. Wild tomato alleles elevate the soluble solids concentration, accounting for 91% of the difference between the two species. Factors for pH were found on 5 chromosomes, with increased pH linked to 4 QTLs and decreased pH linked to 2 QTLs. Together, the QTLs identified for fruit mass, soluble solids, and pH account for 58%, 44%, and 48% respectively of the phenotypic variance among the backcross progeny. Having mapped several QTLs with significant effects, the scientists began working on crosses to isolate them in isogenic lines. This will allow the characterization of QTLs in various dosages, genetic backgrounds, and environments. But it gets saucier than this. The future of QTL lies in transferring desirable quantitative traits from wild species into domestic strains. This will bring a multitude of benefits, including conferring disease resistance, extreme weather tolerance, resource efficiency, and high nutritional quality. Now, if you still can't see the importance of the tomato, maybe it's time to catch up.